Welcome to economics class. Today we are going to learn about the differences between macro and microeconomics. As you've probably just assumed, economics is divided into two areas of study, macroeconomics and microeconomics. Macro means large, so macroeconomics is the study of the entire nation's economy and the issues that affect it, like unemployment, inflation, and consumer spending. Micro means small or individual. Microeconomics looks at the smaller units within the country, like individual people and businesses. Let's use a car to illustrate the difference. If we studied a car the way we study economics, macroeconomics would tell us about how the whole car works. For example, it moves when you press the gas pedal and stops when you press the brake. In contrast, microeconomics would look at individual parts and how they work, like steering wheels and tires turning. In other words, the car is the entire economy, and the car parts are like the individual people and businesses. Now we will discuss goods and services. Both macroeconomics and microeconomics deal with economic products, which we call goods and services. Goods are tangible products, such as food, clothes, cars, and computers. Services are activities that people pay others to do, like haircuts, healthcare, or cell phone repairs. Businesses pay their employees to produce the goods or to provide the services. In turn, employees use their wages to buy goods and services. This creates a cycle whereby people can earn money from businesses and then pay money to businesses for goods and services. This process is known as an economic exchange. Now we will focus on macroeconomics for a few minutes. Macroeconomics deals with the economic exchange between individuals and businesses for an entire nation. A nation's gross domestic product, or GDP, is the value of all the goods and services produced within that country during one year. GDP is the most common way to measure a nation's standard of living, or in other words, how well people are considered to be living in that country. A nation that produces many goods and services has a higher GDP than a nation that produces few goods and services. And the nation with the higher GDP is usually thought to have a higher standard of living. A country's GDP depends on many factors, like the amount of natural resources the country has. Natural resources like oil, water, and land can greatly increase a country's GDP. Conversely, if a nation has few natural resources, it may produce few goods, and therefore have a low GDP. For this reason, the economy is important to many citizens, and they want politicians and other leaders to make it their first priority. In turn, economists, business leaders, and politicians analyze the health of the economy by measuring it. And the way they measure it is often by using the country's GDP. Now we will consider the question, how do nations spend their GDP? Another term for GDP is total output. Let's take a look at how nations spend their total output. Economists list four major uses of output. 1, private consumption. 2, investments. 3, government spending. And 4, net exports. Now let's look at each of these in detail. Private consumption is about the goods and services an individual purchases and uses. For example, consumers spend billions of dollars each year on goods and services such as food, transportation, and healthcare. Investment is the purchase of goods that are not consumed today but are used in the future to create wealth. For example, when a business uses current income to buy new equipment. Government spending is overall public spending on goods and services for national interests. For example, the government spends money on education, defense, and transportation. If you take the value of your country's exports and subtract your imports, you get your net exports. Exports are products made by American companies but sold to people in other countries. Imports are the opposite. They are products produced in other countries but sold to the United States. When exports are greater than imports, net exports are positive. And when exports are less than imports, net exports are negative. In recent years, net exports of products made in the United States have been negative, meaning we import more products than we export. Now we will switch gears and talk about microeconomics. We've been discussing macroeconomics, but remember, microeconomics deals with much smaller units, like individuals, families, and businesses. Microeconomics looks at the behavior and choices of individuals within the economy. It studies specific factors like prices, costs, profits, competition, and consumer behavior. Let's use a peach farmer as an example of microeconomics at work. This farmer sells peaches at a farmer's market. Based on the current price for peaches, the farmer can decide how many peaches to supply in the future. They can increase the peach crop by planting more trees and hiring more workers to pick them. Or they can keep producing at the same amount. Or they can reduce the amount of peaches by selling only the very best of their harvest. Consumers, in other words, shoppers, must then decide if they will buy more, the same amount, or less peaches. So both producers and consumers must make an individual choice, one about selling and one about buying. As consumers, we make many economic decisions. We have to decide whether to buy a house or rent one, whether to wear old shoes or buy new ones, whether to take a trip close to home or to travel abroad. How we choose to spend our money helps determine the demand for goods and services in the economy. Demand is about the amount of goods and services consumers are willing to buy. Supply is the amount of goods and services that are available for sale. But that is a lesson for another day.